And so today we'll look at Psalm 1. I know the pastor has been preaching out of the book of Psalms in the evening, so I thought that I'll preach a psalm as well. Psalm 1. And if we look at that, if you're using the Pew Bible, you'll find that in page 383. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us the opportunity to all come together to bless and to praise your holy name. We pray, Father God, that your spirit may be here with us and that our ears may be attentive and responsive to your word. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 1. We look at Psalm 1. Psalm 1 is an introduction to the rest of the Psalms. There are 150 Psalms, and this is an introduction. It's an introduction to the rest of the Psalms. It's a Psalm of wisdom. And it depicts through illustrations in the two roads of life. It depicts the road that leads to life and the other one to destruction. And you'll see that theme throughout the different Psalms. You also see that one is blessed by God. And in Psalm 1, you'll see the comparison or the juxtaposition of the two, contrasting the wicked and the saint. And so we see this in the Psalms. And in Psalm 1, it reads here, "Blessed is the man. Blessed is the man." And so in life here, we take blessings in different ways. We can say that one is blessed because we look at the physical appearance, or we look at the health of the person, or maybe we may see their material possessions, and we say that person is blessed. And truly they are. There is nothing wrong with any of that, as long as we give glory to God and give him the credit for everything. But we see that. And then we see another person who may not have all the material possessions, but they have the assurance of salvation. And we say that person is blessed. And throughout the Psalms, we see here the blessings. And right here, "blessed is the man," we can translate as happiness, as being happy. Happy is the man. And here in America, we have the pursuit of happiness, and we see happiness as different ways and in different things, and we pursue our happiness in all sorts of different ways. But here in Scripture, the happiness has to do with walking with the Lord, to having that assurance of his salvation, the assurance of his work in our life. And so we see, blessed is the man, happy is the man. Happy is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. There's many counsels out there and many who are giving words of supposedly wisdom that leads to a road of destruction. A road that does not lead to God's happiness, but rather it leads towards destruction. And so, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. And we see here that, back looking at counsel again, there's counsel given by the wicked, it leads to destruction, but there's also counsel through the Word of God. And all of us here, rather than seeking counsel from outside, we should first seek counsel within the house of God, within one another. We should give counsel to a brother and to a sister, godly counsel from his word. That's one reason why we spend time in the word of God, because when a brother or a sister shares something with us, something personal, something intimate, a problem, we could say the word of God says and encourage them and give them strength and tell them what God's word does say. And have that ever happened to any of you that in our times of devotion and times of reading, we read God's word and all of a sudden a brother or sister will share something with us and then we say, ah, I read something about that this morning. Let me share it with you. And we share godly counsel. And so, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. And I grew up in the Pentecostal church, and they always told us that the seat of mockers was the movie theater. And I don't know how many of you guys had that experience, but that's not the seat of mockers. You know, it does depend what you're watching there at the theater, but it's not the seat of mockers. The seat of mockers is placing yourself and sitting in or congregating with a person who mocks and makes fun of God and of his people. And the word continues, it says, but his delight, blessed is the man that is blessed, his delight is in the law of the Lord. And there you go, it's an experience. It's not only having knowledge in the word of God, but it's delighting in it. Of seeing the word of God as lovely and satisfying. It's an experience of the believer that the word of God is a delight. The instruction of the Lord is the delight in the life of the person. The book of the Psalm here, Psalm 1, you'll see it has a delineation. God puts a line of delineation, and we see it here. A delineation between good and evil. Those who follow the Lord and those who follow the way of the world, the system of the world. And you'll see that delineation. The delineation is a clear line described in Scripture that there is only two roads. The road of evil and the road of good. The road of wickedness and the road of good. But today in society, that line, that delineation line is not so clear. Why? Because society has brought into the world something called relativism. And it's saying because culture has changed, the word of God has to change with it. Because culture and society has changed, times have changed, the church has to catch up. And the word of God has to change and has to fit what society dictates is right. And we see this in the world, and we see this with young people, and this isn't new. This has been going on for a few decades now. Where relativism is out there. And we see the world and is saying that because today I feel this way, this is right. And it may not be so tomorrow, but today, this is how I feel. And this is right to me today. Or I choose to do this or that because of these other circumstances. And they have nothing dictating them, nothing giving instructions or straight marching orders because they've strayed away from the Word of God. The Word of God tells us that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so His Word is the same. The Word of God also tells us that there is nothing new under the sun. Man have sinned throughout time and throughout history. And you see the same sins going from Cain and Abel. You see the first murder, and murder continues today. And so the Word of God tells us, thou shalt not murder. And so the Word of God stands true. It stands through the test of time. And it's relevant today. It's absolute. There is an absolute truth. An absolute right and wrong. But the world, because of the desires of the flesh, because what looks good, what tastes good, what feels good dictates their decisions. But it's not so for the believer. The believer is guided by the Word of God, is instructed by the Word of God. And so this is what the world is teaching, relativism. The Word of God teaches us that there is two roads, Cain and Abel. There's the road of Jacob and Esau, and the road of the 11 disciples and of Judas Iscariot. And throughout Scripture, you'll see that there are two roads. And so Psalm 1 here illustrates that there are two roads. It's a psalm of wisdom. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, in the instructions of the Lord. Not in the instructions of the world, not in the instructions of the world system, or how the world sees fit, or of what feels good to you today, but it's in the law of the Lord. The law of the Lord is good. In Deuteronomy chapter 30, if we look at there real quick, in verses 19 and 20, it speaks of these two roads. And God instructs Israel, and he tells them and makes clear what these two roads are. And in verse 19, it reads, "This day I call heaven and earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live and that you may love the Lord your God. Listen to his voice and hold fast to him, for the Lord is your life." The Lord is life. There's only two roads, the road leading to destructions and the road that leads to life. So blessed and happy is one that is upright in relationship with God. It's more than a temporary or circumstantial feeling of happiness. It's a well-being relationship with God. And so we can say that a person is blessed because they have temporary possessions. But the person that has an upright relationship with God is truly blessed and is truly happy. Because it doesn't depend, as we'll see, it doesn't depend on our circumstances or where we find ourselves or what we have as possessions, but it depends on what we have on the inside. As we sung that hymn, Blessed Assurance. Blessed Assurance is something that God gives us through his Son, Jesus Christ. I remember that when my father died, he passed away. And at the moment he passed away, I remember dressing him and making him presentable because they weren't going to remove him that night. And so I was making him presentable, and I'm thinking all that he left, all of this that is in his room. But one thing that he did take with him was that assurance of salvation. That's the important thing. My father was blessed because of that assurance of salvation through Jesus Christ, his Savior. And it wasn't because all of the possessions that he had around him, because none of that went with him. Everything stayed. The assurance and that blessedness came from that right standing through Jesus Christ. And it tells us in Ecclesiastes, what does it say? Vanity is vanity. All is vanity. Or meaninglessness. It's all meaningless unless you have Christ, unless you have God, and you have life through him. So there are two roads. The delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. This is what the blessed man does. The blessed man meditates on God's word because God's word is a delight to him. Because God's word and his instructions is lovely and it's satisfying. He meditates upon it day and night. And I know that we've been instructed and that we have in our time of devotion, and we devote ourselves, you know, 30 minutes a day with the Lord, but sometimes as the day goes on, we forget. What was the devotion all about? You know, what did I read in Scripture today? We have to ponder and think. But this is different. This is more than a devotion. Meditating day and night as you're going throughout the day, meditating upon God's word, chewing the truths, and receiving the nutrients from God's word. You know, sometimes I give my dog a nice juicy piece of meat, and what does he do? He swallows it whole. I'm like, you know, where's the joy in that? Where is the satisfaction? You just take that nice piece of meat, you don't chew it. It tastes good. You know, chew it for a little while. But the dog doesn't know, it just swallows it. And the word of God is like a piece of steak, it's a meat that you take it, you take a slice of it, you chew it and you enjoy it. And you chew it and you chew it and you chew it and you savor the taste of the word of God. And you savor the word. And so you meditate upon it day and night. Meditating upon the word of God. And we can look here in Jeremiah chapter 17. And verse 5 through 8. And we'll compare it there in Jeremiah. Jeremiah in chapter 17 verse 5 it says, this is what the Lord says. Cursed is the one who trusts in man, who depends on flesh for his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. That sounds like verse 1 there, where it talks about walking in the counsel of the wicked. In verse 6 says, he will be like a bush in the wastelands. He will not see prosperity when it comes. He will dwell in the parched places of the desert, in a salt land where no one lives. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. He will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the streams. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. And such is the man that is blessed. Such is the man that meditates on the word of God. He is like a tree planted by streams of water. And have you ever seen a tree in the desert? This tree here that Psalmist describes as a tree that's purposely planted next to the river, next to that stream of water. And this tells us that salvation does not depend on us, but depends on God and on his work, his complete work through his son, Jesus Christ. And it doesn't depend on our works. And so God is the one who planted this tree next to this stream that would give it life. It reminds me that Jesus once stopped by a well, and he spoke to the Samaritan woman, and he told the woman, will you give me water? And the woman says, I'm a Samaritan, and you're a Jew, and you're asking me for water. And Jesus then tells her, I have water, that if you knew that it is water that's forever running. And the woman says, give me of this water so I won't have to come to this well ever again. And she wasn't understanding who Jesus was or what he was offering. And he says, I have water that if you drink of it, you will never thirst again. And from it will bubble eternal life. From this water, it will give you eternal life. And this is this stream here. This is a stream of eternal life. This water that is provided by the Holy Spirit, by the Spirit of God, showing us once again that it's not dependent. The life of this tree is not dependent on its own, but it's dependent upon the work of our Savior, by the work of the Holy Spirit working in us and through us. In verse 3, it says, "He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season." It yields fruit. It yields fruit. In the testimony of our pastor here today, he spoke about his life and his testimony on how God worked through his life. And wasn't it like listening to his testimony? Wasn't it like taking fruit from his tree and savoring it, what God has done in his life and what God has done in all of our lives? We share our testimony. It's like a fruit that we take and we eat of it and we taste of it. And so this is that tree. It's planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season. And so the word of God in us, the life of God produces fruit in us. And it's like the branches and the vine. The vine and the branch. The branch connected to the vine, it has life and it produces fruit. It has to produce fruit. And that branch which doesn't is cut off and is thrown into the fire and it's burned. Why? Because it's useless. A branch that does not produce fruit is useless. So that's the contrast here that we see in verses 3 and 4. We see the tree and we see the chaff in verse 4. The man that is blessed is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff. So we see here the usefulness of the tree. It bears fruit. It gives shade to those who stand under it. It's beauty to the eyes of the beholder. And the tree is beautiful. It has many uses, many purposes. But the wicked, it says here, is like chaff. The wind blows it away. And if we ever seen grain and we've seen how it falls to the floor and those who pick up the grain and they throw it up in the sky, separating the chaff from the grain, the useful from the parts that are unuseful, the chaff just blows away and it's no more because it's useless. And so we look here again, and we'll look in the Old Testament again in Joshua chapter 1 and verse 8, and Joshua here, he's taking command of the army of Israel, and I'm sure he's afraid if he's commanding a great army, and he's going into battle. Who wouldn't be afraid? Knowing that he's going to command an army, knowing that there's going to be death on both ends, some of his men were going to die, and he's going to send them into battle, and he's afraid. And God, it reassures him, and he says, be courageous, be very courageous. And he instructed him in this way. He says, this book of the law should not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe all that is written in it, so that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then your way shall be prosperous, and you shall have much success. Meditating upon the word of God day and night will make you prosperous and successful in all that you do. And we're not talking here prosperity and success in a way of material possessions, of the temporary, but of the permanent, of that which God gives you through salvation through his Son, Jesus Christ. Gives us peace. Gives us assurance, gives us all that we need for eternal life, the gift of salvation. In Proverbs chapter 3 and verses 1 through 6, It also reminds us, and Pastor quoted this verse in the morning, the Proverbs. And it says, my son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you prosperity. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck, write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man. Then it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. The word of God, meditating upon it. Love and faithfulness bound around your neck, written on the tablets of our hearts. And then again here we see in the Shema, in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And this is what God gave to instruct it, the families of Israel, what they should do, the fathers. And in chapter 6 and verse 4 it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. The Shema, O hear, O Israel. And so God is getting their attention and said, do this and you will have prosperity and success. Do this and you will have life. But not so with the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. And then here in verses 5 and 6, we have the conclusion of the life of the wicked and the faithful. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. In verse 6, for the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. The way of the wicked will perish. And so this theme here that we see, the way of the wicked and the way of the righteous, the one who is right standing in relationship with God, we see here that there's a contrast. There's two roads. And it's not like the world says that all roads lead to God. All roads do not lead to God. There's only one road. The other one is to destruction. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean on your own understanding. Our own understanding takes us towards the way of the flesh, toward what we see, what is good. God sees the unseen. He watches over us and he knows what is good for us. And so we seek godly counsel through his word and we meditate on it day and night. The covenant of God is what he gave to Israel in the Old Testament. And today we have the new covenant through his son, Jesus Christ. It's a covenant shed by the blood of our Savior. And it's a covenant that we receive with joy, that we see is lovely and it's satisfying. Remain in the covenant. Remain in Christ. Meditate upon his word day and night. And like the word says, it doesn't depend on our present situation. We may not have all the beautiful things of the world. We may not have all the material possessions. Or we may not have all that we say that the world is blessed with. But if we have Christ, we have everything. We have everything. Christ Jesus satisfies. He satisfies. Even in our most desperate situation and our most difficult trials of life, Christ is there because he promised never to leave us nor forsake us. He says, you have been faithless, but I am always faithful. Christ is always faithful. And so, brothers and sisters, I encourage each and every one of you to delight in the Lord. Delight in the Word of God. May He be your satisfaction. May He be the one that strengthens you and upholds you in every time of your life. Amen. Amen.